So, hello everyone. Let me introduce you all to today's speaker, Sahil Ghazi. Sahil is an undergrad student of mathematics with an inclination towards physics and computer science. He has a keen interest in fiction and non-fiction alike and is an avid thinker with abstract ideas always tinkering in his mind. Though not always making sheer sense, he loves being in his own mind palace. Thank you, Sahil, for being the first student speaker for our online webinars. Handing over to you.
Okay, hi. Thanks, Ankita. This is Sahil. That was a lovely introduction. So I hope everyone knows the topic that I'm going to talk about today. So that goes something like superposition of geometrical dimensions. Now, I want to clarify one thing. That there is a subject called geometrical dimensions in engineering. So I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about the I'm going to talk about the coordinate system or spatial dimensions as we have studied in our mathematics in class 11, 12, and so on. So what I'm going to today is I'm going to introduce you to an idea known as superposition. So we have studied in 11 and 12. We have a little bit idea about what superposition actually is, but we don't have an actual grasp on the concept. Like I want to give you an intuition about how and what superposition is and how does it interacts with everything. So superposition is basically a theory, which I'm going to explain now. So let me start with something known as interference. So I hope everyone has heard about interference. We have studied about an experiment known as the Young's double slit experiment that showed that light interferes with each other. So what I mean when I say that light interferes with each other is that light interferes with each other and forms various patterns and diagrams, which leads to something like this. Okay, so my picture is not opening. Just give me a minute. Can everyone see the picture though? Hello? Can everyone see the picture? Can you just reply me in the comment box? Okay. Now, as I explained that, I'm going to explain an experiment known as Young's double slit experiment. Like, why is this experiment so important? This experiment is important because this proves that light is a wave. Okay. This experiment was done by Young in somewhere around 1800. And this this put a nail in the coffin and it confirmed that light is a wave. What do I mean by this is, we know the delicacies about this experiment that we take a light source and put it somewhere here. Okay, this is a light source. Okay, put it somewhere here in the between. And this is a slit. Then this particular light source, obviously this should be monochromatic in nature. This particular light source then divides into two other light sources. Like this is governed by Huygens principle. So this particular light source then divides into two other light sources, namely S1 and S2. And then these two light sources pass from these two slits, namely S1 and S2, and they interfere with each other. What I mean is you cannot put your hand inside your hand without cutting your hand. So this is something idiotic when I speak it out loud. But what I want to say is, let us consider that you have a unit cube, like a cube with dimensions 1 into 1 into 1. Now, if I say that in a unit cube, can you fit in 1,000,000 balls? The answer would probably no. The balls, like if I specify the dimension of the balls, let's say unit spheres. So can you input? Okay. The screen is not visible. Anurag, okay. So Anurag is saying that the screen is not visible. Ankita, can you confirm is the screen visible or not?
Yes, the screen is visible for me. I think, Anurag, there is an issue in your connection on something because the screen is perfectly visible for me. Just try reconnecting again and... Okay, so I think it was a connection issue. Sahil, please continue.
Okay, So I was explaining the experiment for you. So what I wanted to explain is what interference actually is. I'll just restate my example once again. Let us consider a unit cube with dimensions 1 into 1 into 1. Then I'll pose a question. Then can you fit 1 million unit spheres in this particular unit cube? The answer will be no. Obviously, you cannot, because cubes or spheres that take up space, and when we compare the volume of these spheres and the cube that I'm talking about, they don't compare with each other. Obviously, the volume of these spheres that I'm talking about, 1 million spheres, is much, much higher than the cube. So we cannot fit 1 million cubes inside 1 million unit spheres in a unit cube. But what if I say that can you fit 1 million light rays inside this cube? The answer would be yes, because light can interfere with each other. Light can go inside itself. So what I mean, again, I'll try to explain it by this result. So obviously we know from Young's double slit experiment that when the source of light, when divides into two other sources, these two sources interfere with each other and forms various light fringes on the screen. So this is the screen, various light fringes on the screen. So there is a maximum points and there are minimum points, which means that the maximum points which are talking about, will the light has interfered with itself positively and it has become much more brighter than it was previously. And when I say about the minimas or the minimum fringes, here light has interfered with itself destructively and has destructed itself. So we can see that light interferes with itself in two ways, forming maxima and minima, two points. And obviously, this will result to a series of patterns and so on. So I would like to once again reinstate that interference is a particular property which is only shown by light or similar things. What I mean by similar things is waves. So interference is a property which is primarily associated to waves, and no particle or matter for that matter can show interference. Not unless, like, as soon, like till date, there has been no evidence that a particle can show interference. So when I say interference, you will have to assume that I'm talking about a wave. Only wave can show interference. So this was an experiment that proved that light is a wave. It was done in somewhere near around 1800s. Okay, so after this experiment, I'll like to go into the year 1903, when another experiment was done, namely known as the photoelectric effect. So I have no slides to share about that. I would just like to talk about the photoelectric effect. So what photoelectric effect is, that it was done by Einstein, obviously the famous physicist. So what Einstein did was, he took a metal sheet. Okay, he took a metal sheet and he hit the metal sheet with a light beam with some intensity. And what he saw, that when he hit the light beam, electrons started coming from this sheet. Okay, so the electrons were coming and everything. And what Einstein wanted to do was that when he hit the light rays to this particular sheet, he wanted to see that if Einstein made some changes into the properties of the light ray that has been hitting to the sheets, can the number of electrons that are coming out from the sheet can be varied in any sense. For example, if Einstein increase the intensity of the light beam, will the number of electrons coming out from the sheet will be higher? If he decreased the intensity of the light, will the number of electrons coming out from the sheet will be lower, or vice versa? Now I would like to point one fact from classical mechanics, is that when you look at a wave classically, it means that it depends on the electric field and magnetic field. Okay, so one thing I forgot to mention when I was explaining the interference, like I said that light is a wave. Light is a special type of a wave. It is known as an electromagnetic wave. Obviously we know about that. Okay, I'll go a little bit slow. So I was talking about about an electromagnetic wave. So what an electromagnetic wave is, it is a wave that is made up of electric field and magnetic field, which are perpendicular to each other and are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Which means that, let's just say that there is an electric field E and magnetic field B, then the angle between E and B is 90 degrees. And it is also 90 degrees with respect to the direction of propagation. Okay, so this is a property of electromagnetic waves. Now in classical mechanics, it is a fact that the energy of light directly depends on electric field and magnetic field, which means that energy of the light depends on electric field and magnetic field, and in turn electric field and magnetic field together, they constitute the intensity of the overall wave. Okay, so why I said this, because classically, like in classical mechanics, if you want to vary the energy of the light ray, if you want to like modulate the energy of the light wave, what you have to do is make change in the intensity. That is what Einstein did. He changed the intensity. He made it go higher. He made it go lower. And what he observed was that if you make changes to the intensity of the light, it makes no difference whatsoever to the number of electrons coming out from the metal plate. Okay, so I'll just remind the experiment once again. Einstein took a metal plate. He hit the metal plate with a certain amount of light, which has obviously a substantial amount of energy in it. Now, when the light hit the metal plate, it made the electrons in that particular metal plate come out. What Einstein wanted to do was, wanted to play with the properties of this particular wave that he hit and see whether it makes any changes to the electrons that are coming out or not. So when he made changes to the intensity to the light, he saw that there is no change. Now, according to classical mechanics, this should not happen. If you change the intensity, it should provide more energy to the light, and in turn, the light should hit the electrons with more energy, and more electrons would come out. Now, what Einstein predicted with respect to classical mechanics was wrong. So he concluded that maybe energy does not depend on the intensity. Now, parallelly, there was another experiment conducted, which I don't want to talk about, but I want to take an important result from that particular experiment. So this experiment was being done by Planck, and it was being done on black bodies. Okay, so Planck had a large, huge set of data, which he was unable to fit. This data was related to black bodies. I would just give a brief definition of black bodies. Black bodies is a type of body which can emit each and every type of radiation. That means electromagnetic radiation. Obviously, it is clear that Planck was also working with electromagnetic radiation. So I'm not going to explain the whole experiment, but he had a certain set of data, a lot of data. Okay, now what he wanted to do something with black bodies and stuff, but the data he had, it did not make any sense to him. Now what he did, in mathematics, we have something known as curve fitting. What curve fitting is that you have equations, and you can solve the equations, and you can get various points from it. Let us consider a quadratic equation. You will get two solutions from it. Now you are getting solutions from the equation. What curve fitting does is the exactly opposite thing. You have data, you form the equation from that data. So this is considered cheating in some ways in physics and mathematics. What Planck did was that he had this data which did not make any sense, but it did make any sense if the energy of an EM wave depended on the frequency and not the intensity. So he came up with an equation known as E equals H nu. He came up with this equation E equals to H nu, which meant that, which showed that the energy of an electromagnetic wave is directly proportional to its frequency and not the intensity. Now this equation made perfect sense with the data that Planck had, and Einstein knew about that. So combining the equation that Planck put forward, E equals to H nu, Einstein made his own theory. So what if that E equals to H nu means that light is not wave at all? Like each and every wave is dependent on intensity with respect to its energy. If you increase the intensity, energy will increase. If you decrease the intensity, the energy will decrease. I'm talking this about classically. Like this is true in classical mechanics. But what Einstein found out was when he was doing the photoelectric experiment. For example, when light was interacting with something such as an electron, it did not exhibit the same property a wave should. He then came up with this theory that what if energy is directly proportional to nu, which was already proved by Planck beforehand. But he proposed a new theory that what if light is made up of various particles or various packets of lights known as photons with having energy E equals to H nu. Now all this is very old, and I hope everybody knows about it because we have read it in class 11 and 12 in our syllabus. Now what was happening is that Einstein said that light is particle in nature. So E equals to H nu will only make sense if there are small packets of particle. Einstein said that each and every particle will have energy, which is an integral number, which is an integral of H nu, integral number of H nu. Like there cannot be energy equals to half H nu. There will be always energy equals to 1 H nu or 2 H nu or 3 H nu. It should be a whole number. And it was also proved by experiments, various experiments. So Einstein came up with this theory, what if there are packets in lights and it is made up of particles? So the whole photoelectric effect will only make sense along with the black body experiment that was being done by Planck. These two experiments will only make sense if light were a particle. But as we saw in the interference effect, light is not a particle, light is a wave. And in this second experiment, we saw that light is a particle, light should behave as a particle. So keeping these two things aside, let us move to another experiment. Okay, now this experiment is something similar to a famous experiment that we have studied before. So this particular experiment is known as Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment. So I hope everybody has heard about this alpha scattering experiment, which means that you have the idea about atoms and everything. So we know that atoms are made up of electron, proton and neutron and so on and so forth. So these are supposed to be particle in nature, right? So let us consider another experiment which is similar to the Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment. So what happened, what Rutherford did was he hit a particle to another particle. Like he made two particles collide with each other. Similar experiments have been conducted worldwide. Now the experiment that I'm going to talk about is known as the relativistic heavy ion collider. It was done in CERN, in LHC, the Large Hadron Collider. So what was done was that the scientists took two protons, which are obviously particle in nature. They show properties that a particle should. They don't interfere with each other. They are imagined to be solids. Like we imagine that electron is supposed to be a solid. It is a particle, right? So what these scientists did was they made these two protons collide with each other. Now the amazing thing that happened when these two protons collided, the results were amazing. Like I can only show you how the results were. Now supposedly, I want to also inform you about one more thing, that proton in itself is also made up of something else. Like we were introduced that atom is the smallest particle of a matter, and then atom in itself consists of electron, proton and neutron. So what I want to talk about is tell you is that there are other elementary particles or sub elementary particles. So proton is itself made up of a particle known as a quark, quark. So quark are basically two pointy objects. So there are two types of quark, and up quark and down quark. So I don't want to discuss much about quark, but what you have to know is that proton is made up of quarks, which is another particle. So the quarks are also supposed to be particle. Okay, there are a total of three quarks in the proton. Now what should happen is when these two protons are colliding, when they have collided, we should see at least a maximum of six particles. But that did not happen. What happened was something like this. Okay, my picture app is not working, I guess. I'll open it with Paint. So what happened was something like this. Like when two protons collide, what you see is something like this. Can everyone see the picture? Is everyone with me right now? Hi, hello. Okay, great. So this is how it looks like when two protons collide with each other. Like what is this? These are not six particles. These are not quarks. This does not even look like a particle. So till now, what we have discussed is about that light shows interference. Light interferes with each other. That means light is a wave. Light also does something known as the photoelectric effect, which can only be explained if light were a particle. And we did an experiment, scientists did this experiment and found something like this, that was inside two protons. Like how does that even happen? What is this? So scientists came up with something, they called this particular picture, this is in picture, scientists called it as a quark gluon plasma. This is a fluid basically. The scientists found out that this is a fluid. This is a type of fluid or something that shows fluid-like properties. Fluid as in liquid, I'm talking about liquid, not gas. So this is something that shows liquid-like properties coming out from something that is supposed to have only three particles. this is a plasma. It is known as quark gluon. Scientists later found out that actually the protons are made up of many things. It's not a single thing, quark or etc. etc. So these are all indiscrepancies in our knowledge of physics or whatever happened. Like nothing is supporting each other. So we have studied about, we know about three experiments as of now. I would like to revise once again. Light shows interference, light shows photoelectric effect, and protons show this thing, whatever this is. Like nobody named this thing. The experiment is known as relativistic heavy ion collider, which is a very long name to say. I will just refer this to at this thing. Okay, let me talk about another experiment. So what I'm going to, let me remind you what I'm trying to do is I'm going to explain what superposition is. For that, I have to explain these things. So let me come to my fourth experiment. Okay, now we have established that electron is also a particle. Like till now we know that electron is a particle. We know that proton is not. Proton also shows some liquid-like properties. Proton has liquid in it. At least the experimental results show that. Okay. Till now we know that electron is a particle. It does not show any other discrepancies in its property, or the math that is used to describe the property of electrons does not like mess with each other. So it is all cool as of now. Now let me come to an experiment that was done by a few guys in Hitachi. Hitachi is the the company that made hard disk and ACs and stuff. So it has also a branch that does these kinds of experiments. So some guys at Hitachi had this machine. Let's call this machine. They wanted to experiment with it. They just wanted to test with it. Like, let's see what this can do. What they did was they designed an experiment that was similar to Young's double slit experiment. Okay, something like, okay, I hope everybody remembers the picture that I showed in interference. Let me open it once again. Okay, so I talked about two slits, slit one, slit two, which in turn came from a single slit. Okay, so what happened here was the Hitachi guys were testing their machine, just testing, nothing else. They did not want to achieve anything. It was not a formal experiment whatsoever. What they did was they arranged a similar experiment, just as we can see in this Young's double slit experiment. Instead of light, there were electrons. Obviously, some of you can assume what I'm going to get into as of now. Okay, so what they did was, instead of these light sources, they replaced it with electron guns. These are guns basically that fire electrons. They replaced this with electron guns. Now what happened was, the electron went through this particular slit, then it might have went from this slit or this slit. These are two completely different possibilities. So what they did was, when in Young's double slit experiment, we had a light source. So obviously we know that a light is made up of many waves, but in this case the light was supposed to be monochromatic. So the light was a single wavelength. The light had a single wavelength in nature, right? So the interference that was shown in Young's double slit experiment was by a single wavelength characteristic, right? Now what happened was, when they threw in an electron from here, the electron could have gone from this end or this end. Does not matter as of now. What happened was, they got results which looked something like this. This is the results of electron experiment from Hitachi. Okay. Now let me clarify one thing. They did not throw in a lot of electrons at a single point of time. They threw the electrons one by one. Right, one by one, one by one, one by one, slowly and slowly. So this is the result of that particular experiment. This phenomenon is known as electron diffraction. Okay, now what is happening there? Basically, what is happening is electron is interfering with itself. As I explained earlier, interference is a property that is only shown by something that is wave. You are only supposed to associate interference with something that is a wave. It cannot. It has been proven, it cannot be shown. Interference cannot be shown by matter. Like, you cannot put your hands into your another hand. Like, you cannot like merge your hands, because these take spaces, they have a certain boundary, they have mass, they have matter, they have a certain density, etc., etc. So basically, light is going inside itself. The similar thing was shown by an electron. This is the results of the electron diffraction experiment. This led the scientists to believe that maybe electron is a wave. At least it showed some wave-like properties. Now we have studied about four separate experiments. First of all, we studied interference. Then we studied photoelectric effect. Then we talked about the proton collider thing. Then we talked about electron diffraction. Okay, till now we have cleared one thing, that something which is wave, it can also be something which is a particle and vice versa. Like in some experiments, okay, let me clear one thing. In some experiment, it showed, from some experiment we can concur that a particular thing is wave or a light is wave. From interference, we can concur that, from Young's double slit experiment, we can concur that light is a wave. But from Einstein's photoelectric effect, we can confirm that light is a particle. Light is made up of various particles. Acha. We also know that proton is something that is supposed to be a particle. But from the experiment known as relativistic heavy ion collider, it showed that it also acts as a liquid for that matter. Then in the fourth experiment, we saw that electron, which is supposedly need to behave as a particle, also behaves as light. Like it does what light does. Light is a wave. It interferes with each other. Electron is a particle, but surprisingly, it also interferes with each other. These four things are separately completely different things until a certain point of time. Okay. Now, let me introduce another thing to the whole picture. Wavelength. Like, we know what wavelength is. It's the distance between a wave's trough and crust. Consecutive trough and crust. Crest. What you know is crest. So that is a wavelength. Now, wavelength is also something that characterizes a wave. Obviously, as I defined, a wavelength is the distance between two consecutive crests of a wave and troughs of a wave. It is associated with wave. Let me talk about another experiment. It is known as the Davison and Germer experiment, where they did this experiment and they found out that electrons, I'm not going to explain this experiment though. The result was that they found out that electron is associated with a certain wavelength. Like electron has wavelength. Wavelength is a property that is only shown by waves. Now we can see two things. One, electron interferes with each other, and electron has wavelength. Right. So Davison and Germer experiment, you can find it in class 11 and 12 books, textbooks, I guess, in CBSE syllabus or anywhere in the internet. It is an easy experiment to understand. I'll not talk about it. So what it established was that electron has a wavelength, a definite wavelength. Let me remind you, a definite wavelength, not a lot of wavelengths, a certain series of electrons, a set of electrons will have certain wavelength. There is a formula for that as well. Now, we have talked about five different experiments. We have talked and we have established five various contradicting things. So this is quite the base that I need to establish a concept for superposition. Like, first, let me say, how do you explain these things? Right. Now, a scientist said that light, obviously a scientist, we know the scientist name. Light acts as a particle and as a wave. Now, till date, we have heard that light has dual nature. What does it mean? Has it dual nature, or it acts a certain way depending on the experiments or the condition? For example, light behaves as a wave only during double slit experiment. Light behaves as a particle only during when it's put through the photoelectric effect. Now, these are behavior that are dependent on the experiment that are done on them. Like, the conditions around the thing defines what it is. Right. Now, the thing is, when we say that light has dual nature, do we mean that light is particle and wave at the same point of time? Actually, we don't mean that. At least, we don't mean it that way. Like, a certain thing, let me clear that out. If some of you are thinking that these two can be, like, light can be wave and particle at the same point of time, it is not true. That is why superposition is there. So, light is a wave. We know that. Light is a particle. We have seen that. Now, how do you define these two properties with each other? So, what we say is, I'm going to form a sentence by using the word superposition, particle and wave. These three sentences can help you understand what is happening exactly here. So what I can say is light shows particle-like properties as well as wave-like properties in various experiments with respect to the conditions. So what you can say is light is in a superposition of being a particle and a wave. Light is in a superposition of being a particle and a wave. Until and unless you put the light through an experiment, you won't know what it is. There is a famous experiment known as Schrodinger's cat. It is a joke basically, but most students use it as a joke. But it was an experiment. So Schrodinger put his cat inside a box and he closed it off. He said, is the cat dead or alive? Obviously, if you put in your biology knowledge inside that whole thing, you will say that cat should be dead. But Schrodinger argued that put the biology thing aside for a second. He said that you won't know until and unless you open the whole thing. Is it dead or alive? So I will like to again use the word superposition in another context. So Schrodinger argued that the cat inside this box is in a superposition of being dead and alive. You won't know until and unless you put it into the right conditions. Okay, so basically we can say same thing for an electron. What does an electron do? An electron is in a superposition of being in a particle and a wave alike. That's what I wanted to say. Okay, so I was given 15 minutes to speak and 10 minutes for question and answer. Can I use 5 minutes for question and answer as of now before moving on to dimensions?
Yes, sure, you can do that.
Okay, so I would like to clarify anything that is hindering your minds as of now with respect to whatever I've spoken about superposition and these experiments. So I would like to take a 5 minutes for question. Please, if anybody has any questions, they can ask me. Okay, so I have a question. Can you please tell once more about the 6 particles you spoke about? This is from Sujan Chakraborty. He says that, can you please tell once more about the 6 particles you spoke about? Okay, so I'd like to answer this question part by part. The 6 particles that I spoke about are the same particle. Like what I wanted to say was there is a proton. Inside the proton, there is something known as a quark, Q-U-A-R-K, quark. That was a theory before we did the whole collider experiment with a proton. So before that collider experiment, I want to say, it's just as like we did not know about electrons and protons, so we assume that atom is the smallest unit of a particle. Then we broke atom into subatomic particles. So it's just as the theory evolves with respect to the experiments. So are there any particles in a proton other than quarks? So until a certain point of time, experimentalists and physicists thought that only quarks are there inside a proton. Okay, there are 2 types of quarks. One is known as an up quark and down quark. So a proton, as far as I remember, is made up of 2 up quarks and 1 down quark, or vice versa. I don't exactly remember it. But up to a certain point of time, a single proton has 3 quarks. This is a thought that was considered true by various physicists. So I talk about 6 particles. So these 6 particles were quarks. They are 3 particles each for 1 proton, which collided into each other. These 6 particles is not like it is contained in 1 proton or something. Okay, are there any particles in a proton other than quarks? Yes, there are other particles. As I showed you the picture, there is a liquid known as the quark gluon plasma. There is something known as gluon inside that plasma as well. So this particular liquid is interesting. It is known as a quantum liquid. Now, I would love to explain about it as well, but the thing is that it would take another 15 minutes. So basically, I would like to just give you a hint. This particular quantum liquid, the quark gluon plasma that I talk about, is something that is synonymous to a black hole, right? The quantum liquid can help predict the properties that are shown by the black hole. These 2 things are governed by the same mathematical and physical principles. Okay, apart from up and down quarks, what are the others which constitute the 6 particles? All the 6 particles are constituted of only up and down quarks. Okay, I hope I was able to answer the question, Sujan. Okay, anyone else want to clarify anything? Okay, shall I continue, Ankita?
Yes, please continue.
Okay, so till now we have established that, I would like to repeat my sentence once again with respect to lights and electrons. So light in certain conditions shows that it is a particle, and in certain condition it shows that it is a wave. What is more appropriate is that we say light is in a superposition of being a wave and a particle. Similarly, an electron is in a superposition of being a wave and a particle. Okay, now the thing is that let me introduce something known as geometry into the whole picture. Everybody has heard about geometry, because geometry is everything that mathematics, like, it is the most important thing about mathematics, geometry, according to me, because it is one of the earliest branches of mathematics that was invented, and each and everything can be explained with respect to geometry. For example, let's suppose you have an equation. Every equation has some curve that is related to it. Like, if you have a thought that you can express with respect to an equation, you'll also have a certain curve that is related to it that you can express using graphs and geometry and other things. Right. Now, we know that a wave can be represented by a sinusoidal curve, which means that it can be represented by the same graph as sine x. Right. So that is what is interesting about waves. The waves have some property known as amplitude. It has wavelength. Now, I hope everyone will agree that these things, the amplitude, the wavelength, and other stuff about a wave is much more, like, very, very easier to understand in a graph. Right. So if we introduce geometry into the whole thing, we know how to represent a sinusoidal wave. We know how that works. Right. Now, let me diverge from the topic and consider a particle. We can also show a particle in a graph, right? We can tell you, or at least some mathematicians who have the knowledge, proper knowledge, they can tell you with respect to a certain time and certain origin, where an electron is, where is its position, in which dimension does it lies. When I use the word dimension, I don't necessarily means the normal dimensions that we are used to. Okay, now breaking from the whole discussion chain, I would like to introduce another thing. Like, we have noticed that, let us consider a cube, right? A cube is made up of 6 squares, right? A cube is a three-dimensional thing, supposedly it is a three-dimensional thing, which is made up of squares, 6 squares, 6 sides each, right? Three-dimensional things that is made up of two-dimensional stuff. A cube is made up of squares. Square is a two-dimensional figure. We can explain it only by the help of x and y axis. Again, following the pattern, we know that a square is in turn formed by lines, right? Lines which are two-dimensional in nature. So a three-dimensional object is made up of two-dimensional things. A two-dimensional object is in turn made up of one-dimensional things, a line. Now let me introduce you the concept of zero dimension. Like, it is simple, it's just like sounds something that is amazing, but it is not actually. Just a point is known as a zero dimension, just to like name the thing. So a line which is one-dimensional, it is made up of two endpoints, which is considered as zero dimension. Now if we apply the same logic, so on and so forth, we should have something known as a negative dimension, and we also should have something that is greater than 3. So following the same logic, there should be a four-dimensional entity which is formed by cubes. So let me explain it once again. Let us consider a cube. Cube is a 3D object made up of 2D object. A 2D object square is made up of a 1D object. A 1D object is made up of 0D objects, zero-dimensional objects. Similarly, zero-dimensional objects make up one-dimensional object. One-dimensional object make up two-dimensional objects. Two-dimensional objects make up three-dimensional objects. Similarly, three-dimensional objects should make up four-dimensional objects. You have to believe my word. Believe me for what I'm saying is that there is a something that is known as a hypercube that exists in 4 dimension, made up of 8 3D cubes. Like, it is hard to imagine. That is what dimensions are all about. So I don't want you to imagine anything. I just want to say that just logically accept the pattern that we have here. So I'm not going to talk about negative dimensions. Some physicists argue and mathematicians argue that negative dimensions is just a hoax, just for fun and everything. But some physicists do believe that there are negative dimensions as well. But there is no physical proof of the existence of dimension. I want to clarify that. Everything is based on like theory. So if we follow the same thing, if we follow the same rule, 3D, 4D, 1, then there is supposed to be something which is five dimensional in nature, which is made up of four dimensional objects. So this logic continues. And this was one of the first idea that mathematicians had about higher dimensions. Now, I want to clarify one more thing, that in physics, sometimes we consider time as the four dimensions. What does it mean? Is that if you are a certain position, then there should be a time that is associated with that particular position. For example, you are attending this meeting at 6:15 p.m. Right? You cannot be 2 hours at 6:15 p.m. We are not in superposition. We cannot be in superposition because we are macroscopic objects. Obviously, another thing that I want to clarify, that all these properties about superposition that I talked about are only strictly shown by microscopic objects and not macroscopic objects. Suddenly, if you want to say that, Sahil, can you be in a superposition of being a wave and a particle? No, I cannot. I can, if I can run with the speed of light, I can, certainly I can, but I don't think I will be alive for that. However, moving forward, so these dimensions, these exist. Right. This was one of the primary arguments that were put forward for the existence of geometrical dimensions or spatial dimensions. So I talked about time dimensions. In physics, sometimes the time is considered as the fourth dimension. Like there is a position, it always has to be associated with a certain time. And if there is a time, it has to be associated with a certain position. You cannot just arbitrarily say 6:15 p.m. You have to, like in mathematics, if you, I can say 6:15 p.m. without telling you the context. But if I'm doing an experiment and I have to record time, I will have to associate with it a function, f of t or f of x for that matter, which means function of distance, function of time. So in our studies, we have to associate time with position and position with time. This is one of the amazing things that is also available in quantum mechanics that I was talking about superposition, but I'm not going to discuss with that. Okay, moving on. Now, this 0D, 1D, 2D, 3D thing, this was the primary ideas about higher dimensions. Let me speak about something much more intuitive to you people. We know about integration, right? We know that it came from the application of areas. Like an integral helps us finding areas. Integration was first invented by Riemann, someone named Bernhard Riemann. He was an amazing scientist and scientist mathematician basically, and he was the one that argued logically about higher dimensions. He's a working authority on, like, he's a great authority on higher dimensions. I don't know which century he was from though, but great guy. So this Riemann, he said that he told about the concept of higher dimensions. For example, a single integration, like integration of, let's say something, integration of dx, it will give us x. So integration is based on the calculation of areas. When we do an integral, it is always associated with an area. Like to put that into much more broader perspective, when we talk about pi, there is always a circle related, because the basic definition of pi comes from a circle, right? Similarly, if we talk about integration, it is always and every time should be linked to something for the calculation of area, always. For example, if we know about vector areas, it is also a closed integral of something, electric field, etc., etc. So when we talk about integration, automatically you should assume that there is area involved. Okay. Now I want to introduce something else known as a double integration. People who are in mathematics major, they know about it. So a double integration, what it does, it calculates the volume. Right, we have single integration. When we integrate one time, like it's just about double differential or second order differentiation or third order differentiation, something like that. Not exactly similar though, but you can use it to help understand the whole second two integral or three integral stuff. So when we integrate something one time, it gives us area. When we integrate something two times, it gives us volume, proven by Riemann, of course. we also have something known as triple integral. That is the maximum that we have with respect to integration. We have also something called triple integral. Now, triple integration is something that is not applied everywhere, but it is it can be put into a broader perspective if you look some mathematical problems that involve triple integral. So I urge everyone to look out some mathematical problems that uses triple integration. So you'll be able to understand what am I talking about the dimension and stuff. So the existence of triple integral implies that something greater than third dimension should exist. And this triple integral is logical with everything that we have with respect to mathematics and dimensions and everything. Like theoretically, I'm speaking. Theoretically, triple integral is a fit with everything that we have with respect to mathematics and physics. Even integration in higher dimension is done in something known as string theory. String theory makes use of higher dimensions. So what I wanted to say was there is something known as a higher dimension. What I'm talking about is spatial dimension or geometrical dimension. Like just as something known as length, breadth and height, you have another entity that defines another aerial category of a certain shape or anything. You don't have to imagine anything, however. You just have to believe me that there is something that exists in higher dimension. Or higher dimension exists. You have to just take my word for it. As of now, you can do fact checking later though. However, moving on. So we have established that higher dimensions exist. Now, how does it comes into play with superposition? Like the name of this webinar is superposition of geometrical dimensions. Basically, that is a name that I just came up with because it sounded cool. Is it? It is cool, right? It is very cool. It sounds very cool. Now, what does it mean exactly? How can superposition be related to higher dimensions? You'll find many articles and many papers that relates the exact same thing. Somehow or the other, you can only understand superposition if you relate it with higher dimensions. Now, what I want to talk about specifically in superposition of geometrical dimension is that we know that a wave, it can be explained with respect to two dimensions. It can be explained with respect to three dimensions. Now, we have also a particle which can be a wave cannot be represented with respect to one dimension. It's impossible because we have electromagnetic waves, which means that we have electric and magnetic waves which are vibrating and oscillating with respect to each other at a 90 degree angle. So we would always need two dimensions, or at least two dimensions. Actually, what I'm saying is completely false. Basically, you cannot always define an electromagnetic wave in two dimensions because they are oscillating with each other at 90 degree. Everybody has seen the three dimensional representation of an electromagnetic wave. So we need three dimensions to explain each and every characteristic about an EM wave, but we can do it in two dimensions up to a certain level. Now, let's come to a point. So we have established that we need two dimensions minimum to understand wave, and to completely understand it, we will require three dimensions, x, y, and z axis for that matter. If you want to understand about a particle, if you just want its position at a certain point of time, we can make use of one dimension. Right, we can use two dimensions. If you want to see it in space, we can space three dimensions, so on and so forth. Now, the thing is, we can separately understand the wave nature with respect to a certain number of dimensions. We can separately understand particle nature. Now, I've already stated the fact that when I say light has dual nature, or when I say electron has dual nature, or anybody for that matter, does not mean that they are particle and wave at the same point of time. That is not exactly what is possible with respect to various laws in physics. You will only know what it is, and it can behave as both. It is just like your two hands. Let us assume that you have right and left. Let us assume a population of humans which has only one hand. And now here comes another human with two hands, and he chooses to show only right hand at a certain point of time. And when he shows the left hand, he hides the right hand at a certain point of time. I don't know if I'm clear or not. However, let me explain the whole example once again. Let us assume that the earth has only humans with one hand, only the left hand. Right. Now here comes a human, a new type of species, who has two hands. but he chose to show only one hand at a time. Like to some people he showed his left hand, and when to some people he showed his right hand. But the point is, when he was showing his left hand, he was hiding his right hand in some way or the other. I just don't ask me how is he hiding the hands or everything. Just assume that when he's hiding his hand, people cannot see his hand. So he's not showing both of his hands at a certain point of time. But we know that he has both the hands. This is something, an example that can be understood, that can be used to understand superposition for that matter. Now, similarly, what I was explaining is that electron also shows wave-like properties and point-like properties, and they need separate things, separate dimensions and separate representation. Like to show a wave nature, we have to use a sine wave and cos wave, right? We have to use Fourier analysis, something known as Fourier analysis, to show wave nature of the particle, to distribute it. For example, a wave can be made up of two or three more waves, like a wave with wavelength lambda 1 and a wave with wavelength lambda 2 can form another new wave. Right, we know this from the superposition of waves. Now, there is no, what I want to say is there is no proper representation that exactly puts a picture as to how the superposition works. What I mean is that when I cited the example, that we can always imagine how a person would look like with only one hand and how a person would look like two hands, because we have seen the two hands. Now, in my example, just imagine that nobody has seen two hands at the same point of time. Nobody. They will automatically assume that it cannot happen. It will put a bar to our intuition. Like we cannot imagine the whole thing logically at any point of time. We cannot. It's just impossible. If we haven't seen the two hands of the person who has these two both hands at the same point of time, we will never be imagined how does it fit into the whole body? How does it work even? Like there is no diagrammatical or geometrical representation for that. Similarly, nobody has seen an electron behaving as a particle and as a wave At the same point of time, what I'm saying is at an instantaneous point. Okay, let us just stop the space-time for one moment. And if the world was about to stop for 1 second, in this particular second, there will be no electron who will behave as a wave as well as a particle simultaneously. If we stop the time, if an electron were supposedly behaving as a wave, it would remain a wave. And if an electron would have supposedly been behaving as a particle, it would have remained a particle. What I want to say is, we cannot form a picture without separating these two things. But we know that these two things are not separate. Wave and particle is not separate. So as argued by someone known as de Broglie, there was a scientist known as de Broglie, or more popularly known as de Broglie. So he said that matter has a wave associated with it, and in turn has a wave number. So matter has wave associated with it. It is known as a de Broglie wavelength. So me, you, everyone, we have a wave according to de Broglie. He said that we have a wave and we are particle as well. He argued that with respect and provided proper mathematical calculations for it as well. Now, what I want to say is, superposition is something that cannot be applied to imaginary thing, like imaginary thing, which you cannot touch or feel or see, etc. Superposition can only be applied to something that exists, or at least we see the effect. There is something known as cause and effect. If there is an effect, there has to be a cause. So we can see the effects from interference, from electron diffraction, from photoelectric effect, and we assume this to be the cause. For a photoelectric effect, light is a particle. This is the cause. For interference, light is a wave. This is the cause. So we have cause and we have effect. For dimensions whatsoever, we only have, what do you say? We only have cause. We have speculated causes. Like the whole idea of dimension, it cannot be false. It can be false, what I want to say. It can be completely bogus. Maybe after 100 years, physicists want to like change the whole dimension or thing. They want to introduce something else. Like maybe dimension does not exist. For example, when light was newly discovered, people did not know that light did not need a medium. So people assumed, some of the scientists assume that light travels with its own medium. It carries its own medium something known as ether. So it carries ether and moves. What I want to say is, if moving forward in the future, if we invent that geometrical dimensions that are something which are something physical, we can at least feel them or see some effect. We cannot see any effect whatsoever of geometrical dimensions. Not practically, at least. Theoretically, we can, but not practically. So until and unless the practical and the theory part comes together, we cannot correctly assume everything about dimensions. Now, these higher dimensions, they exist, we know about, but they might not be dimensions. They might be something else. Just as the relativistic heavy ion collider experiment, we thought that protons were particles. When they collided, we saw something that was similar to liquid. This is all possible. So what I'm saying is, if we are able to establish the fact that dimensions are physical, like we can feel dimensions, we can do stuff with it. We can see a 4D cube, a 4D hypersphere, or quaternions, which are again higher dimension shapes. Then we might be able to superimpose them. We might be able to argue that these are different things. A single dimension can be in a superposition of two dimensions. For example, let us consider a dimension X, the dimension Y. I'm not talking about the Cartesian coordinates X and Y. I'm just assuming that like fourth dimension, fifth dimension, sixth dimension, up to n dimensions. So let name this nx, and let name another set of dimensions y. So if I can argue, possibly I would be able to argue, if we have the proof of, what do we say, we have the proof that dimensions actually exist. So we might be able to argue that dimensions with respect to being x and y can also be in a superposition of being x and y. That's all. Thank you. I can take questions now, I guess.
So if anyone has any questions, please go ahead.
Hi, does anybody have any questions? Yeah, I guess no.
Okay, so thank you so much, Sahil, for giving us your time. Hope you enjoyed speaking for our webinar. And yeah, that's
yes,
it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Just on an ending note, if anybody wants to read about superposition and quantum theory and dimensions, there is a course known as MIT OpenCW on YouTube. You can look it up.
Okay, so Sahil, Saptoshi has a question. So Saptoshi, yeah, can you just unmute yourself and ask your question?
Hello.
Yeah, hi.
I have a question.
Yes, Saptoshi, yes. Yeah, hi.
Yeah, so can you explain about the fifth dimension that was mentioned in the movie Interstellar?
Interstellar, okay. I have seen the movie though, but I don't remember as vividly as I would like to right now. But the dimensions that were talked about in Interstellar is something different that I'm talking about right now. Like, it was not completely fiction. I would like to reinstate that. Like, we can talk about dimensions in various ways. Right, we can explain it mathematically, and we can explain it just with pure theoretically, just as I've explained as of now. So I don't have the exact idea about the fifth dimension that was being explained in that particular movie. Maybe it was something. I think there is a video by a channel known as 3Blue1Brown. You can search 3B1B higher dimensions. That video explains your question, as far as I remember.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, so if you don't mind, Sahil, can I say something on that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so in Interstellar, basically, time was shown as a fifth dimension. Time was shown as a physical dimension, okay. Right? Because when they go to the Tesseract, every single moment is like a dimension. It's there present physically. So yeah, that is it. And if anyone wants to read more on that, there is this book, The Science of Interstellar by Kip Thorne, as Sahil said, that movie isn't entirely fiction, it's very much real and possible. So yeah, anyone can feel free. And plus, Sahil, you also mentioned 3 blue, 1 brown, right?
Yes.
So yeah, so even you can reference that as Sahil said. So anything else? Okay, so I think that will be all, Sahil. Thank you so much for giving us your time. And okay, anyone who wants to reference this video later, it will be present on our YouTube channel, Pi Paradox, as well. So you can reference it later. That's all for today. You can leave the meeting now.